The Luck Doctress at Macon Styles. Locks it down.
Luck Doctress, got it on lock.
Got it on lock. 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 MaconStyles.com.
I'm the Lock Doctress of MaconStyles.com, and today I have a special guest. Her name is Asha Mandela, and she's the holder of the world's longest locks. And I know a lot of people have been curious in submitting their questions to ask her, so I'll be doing this interview today, and thank you so much for having me.
Thank you so much for this interview.
Yes, absolutely. So we'll get started with the number one question that I've received from a lot of people is, what products do you use on your hair? So they want to know how they've grown so long, and is it just genetics, or is it a special ingredient that you're using in your products to make them grow so long?
It's a really good question, because a lot of people ask me that. And I actually do have my own brand of hair products, which has been a huge plus in the length of my hair. It's a combination of the products, and I'm not sure for genetics, but it's also on a spiritual thing where it took on a life of its own. But in terms of the products, yes, I created a formula like 15 years ago when I was going through chemo for breast cancer, and nothing I used was really working. So I came up with all the different ingredients that work for me, plus two secret ingredients, one from India, one from Africa, that's in there. And with the help of that, it's worked really well in protecting my locks. I mean, you go through breakage and stuff, sometimes you can't get away from that.
Exactly.
But in terms of protecting it, where I didn't lose them from chemo and all that stuff, mm-hmm. It's worked really well.
That's really amazing. So with the length of your locks, how do you really keep your roots from thinning and just protect your roots from those common issues that come with the weight of locks that happen over those years?
Well, my locks, first of all, weighs like about, I would say probably about 25 or 30 pounds, maybe a little bit more because it's been a while. But one of the things I learned within the last, I would say, 6 years, it's the way in which I carried. I carried like African women carry their babies, across the shoulder or around the waist on the back. So that takes away a lot of any of the burden of the weight of me feeling it.
Right.
So I don't have that pulling and all that struggle with the weight and stuff at all. And to sleep at night, I lay either next to me or on the floor and a sheet or something.
Beautiful.
And it's like it's so much that I can move around without it pulling. So I don't really have any weight issues with it here at all because of the way I carry it. It's only within the last 4 years of learn the word free form. I used to say that my locks was homegrown. That's mm-hmm. how I would refer to it. And I guess I sounded kind of maybe a little bit illiterate to some people because I didn't know. Because the thing with me is that I don't know a lot about locks. I just know about my locks. It started out as, and I really wasn't into locks, I'll tell you right now. I really wasn't into locks. I was totally in the world of weave and braids. Girl, I was a queen of weave and braids.
I would have never guessed.
Yeah, a lot of makeup, weave and braids. But then 35 years ago, I started going through this transition where, on the spiritual realm, where I started having dreams and visions in the spiritual realm again, and telling me that I needed to stop dressing the way I was, because I had also liked the spandex and pom-pom shorts too,
mm-hmm.
and to stop dressing that way, and that I should grow locks. And I didn't want to hear it. I'd been waking up in these dreams like, are you serious? Me growing locks? No, I couldn't imagine it. And then I just let it grow, but it was like just little pieces like this.
Right.
And still it was hard for me to work with. I was like totally embarrassed to go, and I'm like, this is not me. I miss having the braids and the weave. It was hard, but it took me like another 6 months to really get into it.
Mm-hmm.
And then I didn't want them big because I didn't understand the freeform part of it. Nor even the seriousness and the sincerity of the cultural part of it,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So I just figured, okay, I'm getting instructions to grow locks. I'm gonna go ahead and grow it. But I just wanted them like the size of my fingers, so like two or three.
Mm-hmm.
Because I realized also, even though I don't feel the full weight of it, some of it started thinning in different areas.
Right,
so I let
right.
it butt together. So you'd find that in the full length, some of them would be like fingers.
Yeah.
And then going up to the roof, it's fat.
Right. Okay. I actually did some of those combinations to my hair as well, mm-hmm. what you're describing as some of them thinning.
Yeah.
So I know that you mentioned the spirituality with your locks. So do you sage your locks to cleanse them of negative energy? If you say if you encounter just being different places, do you sage them often?
I wouldn't say necessarily sage. Sage is a part of the process of cleansing anyway with my home, which I do like once a week or maybe twice a month. Mm-hmm. But also, I'm a priestess. Mm-hmm. You know, I do spiritual readings, I do spiritual work. So with that in itself comes a lot of cleansing. Yeah. So whenever the cleansing process comes in, yes, sage is a part of it, but not to the hair itself.
Right.
Well, I mostly use a water that a lot of spiritual people use in a bottle that's called Florida water. Mm-hmm. A lot of times when I come in contact with clients or different things, yes, I can rinse my hair with the Florida water or I would sprinkle some of it, and that is a form of cleansing also. It doesn't necessarily right. have to be the sage or frankincense or myrrh because it's also really smoky. And
exactly.
you don't want to walk around smelling like, you know, you're hanging out in a bar or something. So mostly the Florida water.
That's good to know. And pertaining to a controversial topic, it's now legal for the workplace to discriminate against lock wearers. So a lot of people are cutting their locks due to their jobs, and they're really feeling like they're being disconnected from their hair and their spirituality in order to have a job. So what advice do you have for those who are considering starting locks and considering that they're in corporate America and they have to have jobs and things like that to make a living?
Well, first of all, I had absolutely no idea that that was going on, maybe because I'm self-employed. Mm-hmm. I'm interacting with people, but I wasn't hearing that because my understanding is that in certain workplaces, as long as you pull it back, like if you were in the food business and stuff, you pull it back in a net, it's okay, but it really can discriminate against you that way because mm-hmm. it's your way of life. It's not right. necessarily a style and fashion.
Right.
It's another form of religion, so to speak.
Yes.
I think that I would say to people that there's a lot of people that I know, like even Caribbean parents, even though there's a lot of Rastafarians in the Caribbean, a lot of their parents still don't like it, but they are Rastafarians in their heart and in their way of life. They just don't have the locks. So I would say to people, I mean, like, depending on your field, if you know that you're going to be in a corporate field and it's not allowed, then that still shouldn't take it away from you because it's your way of life, it's your thinking, it's your method of purchase stuff. You just need to have it in a hairstyle, you know, if you want to look at it as a hairstyle, because a lot of people still take it as, I think it's the people that does negative stuff with it that's making it bad for people who is really positive on that realm.
Right.
Some people have it because it's not a spiritual thing. It's because they want to tap into their culture or their ancestors. You know, like, I am black or I'm natural. But growing natural doesn't necessarily mean that you have to grow locks. You know, obviously, I'm not going to be in anything corporate or anything like that because cutting my baby is not going to happen.
Yeah, exactly. I completely agree that for you being here in America where so many think that locks are dreadful, you know, the whole locks versus dreads debate, a lot of people just say that they're locks because they're not dreadful. Did you experience any type of negativity being here in this culture where they don't really embrace locks like that and they perceive them as rebellious?
It was actually better for me starting my locks here in the US than in the Caribbean, because in the Caribbean they're still so colonial, so to speak, in so many ways. Again, even though there are a lot of locks and Rastafarians there, back in those days, before I migrated here, I couldn't grow locks in my mom's house. That would have been like a crime, you know? And when I migrated here and I started growing my locks, even when I took the first set of pictures and I sent for my mom, she said to me, I can't believe I used to groom your hair so nicely. And I'm talking Vaseline back in those days, okay? I used to groom your hair so nicely and look what you done did with it. Now it's looking like a little mop. And she couldn't cope with it. And I had to send her back a letter and says, well, Mom, you know, I'm over 80 now. I'm out of your house. I'm in America. I'm so far away that you can't cut it while I'm sleeping. Mm-hmm. But gradually, she got used to it, and she was fine. And now she's really proud of me. I was getting more respect when I started growing my locks. I'm guessing maybe they looked at me like, okay, she's got to be a strong person to really deal with this. So we don't have a choice but to respect her. I just couldn't figure out what was going on with them. But I knew that I went from being a weak person, maybe in their eyes, to being someone strong. that locks is matted hair, right? And within that, you're thinking like, it's only if you can comb the hair out or with a free flow and rinsing it that the dirt and the buildup is gonna come out. But then again, once I got the call in, it's like, you know, someone saying you never know until you walk in someone else's shoe.
That's true.
So once I started growing locks, I realized, well, you can actually clean it, because I think I was washing my locks too much, you know, and still do once a week. And it gets clean and I don't have any problems with any buildup. Yes, you get a little lint, and I learned to realize that the lint, you can't really get rid of the lint. So I dye my hair once a year.
Right. Yes, that is definitely the mm-hmm. best thing. As a loctician, mm-hmm. I tell people that as well, that it's just best to dye your hair mm-hmm. because I find that so many clients are just trying to pick and pick and pick that
and
lint out and it breaks the locks. And mm-hmm. then they have a situation where they have to repair them.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm like, if you don't want to keep coming in for costly repairs, just do a dye and just conceal the lint instead of trying to pick it out so much.
I totally agree, because no one taught me that. I had to figure it out.
As far as buildup, as far as product buildup, you don't really use a lot of shelf products, which cause the buildup in the first place. So I know a lot of people are asking questions about how do you prevent buildup that comes into the locks. And I tell clients that it's a result of the products that you're using that's causing that buildup. And since you have your own natural line of products, mm-hmm. I'm sure it's formulated to a way that's going to be healthy for your locks and avoid buildup.
And that's why within my products, I went with the peppermint, because my shampoo is a peppermint shampoo. Because again, with kinky hair and matted hair, I think it's different to process hair and Caucasian hair, where you use other products and it would go freely through it. Our hair is matted or our hair is kinky, so you need a little bit more to get in there, especially with all the different products. There's people out there that are serious product junkies. And I try to tell people, when you use my products, I'm not saying it's the best in the market. It would work for me, it would work for 10 people, but it may not work for 5 people, because everyone reacts to stuff differently.
Retwisting your hair is really necessary for your hair to lock, or do you think your hair locks regardless if you retwist it or not?
Based on my experience, I'm not a loctician, but I'm going based on my experience. I think with some people, they think that they need to twist. I think that the main reason for twisting is to keep it neat,
mm-hmm.
to keep it neat so that it doesn't look all, you know, iffy.
Yeah.
And but I think if your hair is gonna lock anyway, it's just that with the twisting, it locks a little bit closer to the root, as opposed to, like, you know, you have this much, and then it starts locking from here and the root is open. That's what I experienced with mine. I used to twist a little bit and then I stopped. There was a time I wasn't twisting at all. And then, like, within the last couple of years, like doing little interviews and stuff, where I just left it as it is, not really considering it to be freeform, but just leaving it as it is. And I would get comments from people that'd be like, well, you know, she's a Guinness holder and she's this and she's that, and why is my hair looking all neat? So it's like there's some people who didn't really care. They like the total natural look, and there's some people who are thinking that I'm on camera and I should have it neat. So then for a couple professional photo shoots, I started twisting, and I didn't really like that, because it was a fight to hold on to my hair to begin with from all the chemo and stuff that caused the damage. And it would have been worse, even if I may have thinning in other areas, because nothing is perfect. Even if I have thinning in other areas, trust me, it would have been worse had I not come up with my formula that really worked for me. And then I use a lot of aloe.
Right, right.
Like me, like, I'm not twisting. You know, when my husband helped me wash my hair, I wash and we groom with the butter and the moisturizer and stuff, but no twisting,
mm-hmm.
you know? And a lot of people still can't cope with it. So they want the locks, but they want to make sure it looks neat. So they have it, and then they don't understand why they're having a lot of breakage.
Right.
And what I tell people, you can buy the best products on the market. You're treating it on the outside. What about treating your body on the inside? You have to treat it like a plant. If you buy a pretty plant and you're watering the plant, but then you also have to give the plant a little fertilizer and stuff sometimes. So it's the same with your hair. You buy all the fancy products, but you have to take, as far as I'm concerned, supplements. I do a lot of supplements, a lot of biotin, hair, skin and nails, high doses of a lot of stuff. Drinking a lot of water and taking care of your body. A lot of people don't realize that. So they're using a lot of stuff on their head, but they're eating anything. They're not taking supplements. They're not doing a lot of stuff, not even drinking. You ask somebody, how many glasses of water you have a day? Well, I haven't drunk water all week. I drink juice and, you know, because you have to treat it on the inside. What you put on the inside, it helps reflect what's going on the outside, and then you have the products for the outside. Mm-hmm. And that's how we work ours. Okay. I don't like dryers. You know, the same way when I wash my hair laid out on the patio, let the sun hit it to dry. I don't use dryers, but I'm just
aggressive. And so that concludes all of the questions that I had for from people about your hair. And I just wanted to know if at this time, can we just do an unraveling and show the length of your hair?
Sure. It's always okay. The reveal moment. But one of the things in terms of washing my hair, people always want to know how often I wash it. Okay. In terms of taking a shower, I tie it up in a bundle with a little knot. And when I go into the shower, I have a little hanger in the shower. And I put it there so it pulls it away from me. So I'm actually able to take a shower without my hair getting in the way.
So you literally hang your locks in the shower.
I hang it in the shower.
Okay.
There's a little hook.
I look forward to seeing that.
Yeah. There's a little. Last time I measured it in Orlando, probably about, I don't know, maybe 2 or 3 months ago, we were quite surprised that it was hitting 100, and that's the longest one.
100 feet.
Yes, which is this one here. This one that we have separate.
Yeah.
It is 100, I think, already. And all the rest, they come in different lengths of, you know, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 80. But the longest one of the bunch is this one here. I'm not sure how you want to.
Yeah, so I would love to just help you unravel it. So do I start from here?
You can start with these bottom here.
Okay, so I'll just collect it.
Because that one is actually separate anyway.
Okay.
And even if you unravel it, it's going to go so far. You have to follow it everywhere
right
to get to the end. I mean, I don't mind. I'm just saying that we'll have to follow it.
And so, yes, you've mastered holding them like a baby, like the African women do the carriers.
It is my baby, trust me, this hair is my baby. When everybody else get me upset and fail me, my baby stays with me. And I couldn't imagine when anybody asked me, are you gonna cut your hair? Do you think you're gonna cut it? I used to get really upset when people ask me that, but then I realized they don't really, really understand.
Right,
that
they
this
don't.
Is a commitment,
mm-hmm.
This is my way of life, and it's something that I'm totally committed to. I had an agreement with my ancestors. It's not going anywhere.
Yeah, so this is it. This is like these little repairs. And sometimes people are looking for perfection with locks.
Mm-hmm.
So they're like, how do you avoid those weak spots and so on and so forth? But there's no way to really avoid it. It's just part of the journey. And
I try to catch them before they break though.
Yeah.
Because once it's broken, that's it.
Right.
You know, but I really try to, and then you'd find that in some areas you'd find like a lot of little knots in different places.
Mm-hmm.
And some of these is where like it was gonna be more than one at one point and it broke off.
Right.
But once I catch up with it, I tie it in a knot really quick because I just every time I feel like I'm losing piece, I just start getting crazy because like it's a part of me that's going missing.
Right.
But I can't cope with it.
How much shampoo do you really use? See, I use black soap because with me and my locks, they're like waist length now.
Mm-hmm.
And I find that black soap just gives a much better lather.
Mm-hmm.
Is it the same for you or what do you use as far as like, say if you're using your shampoo, do you use a lot of bottles of shampoo or you only focus on your scalp so it's not really that much?
You know, back in the days, I used to use the black soap and it is good. I must admit. Yeah. Now if I use a black soap, I use it for showering because it's also good for the body.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it kills bacteria and stuff
right
in the skin. In terms of my shampoo with the top, it's not a whole lot. But when I'm doing the full length, I would say probably, depending on how much washing I want to do that day, I would say maybe 4 to 6 bottles sometimes. But once I'm in, this is where it goes. So once it's here, if there's any little pieces hanging, then I just tie it up. But once it's there, I'm like this, and the shower is on, and I'm showering up a storm, and the baby's not in the way. I can turn around, I can do anything I want, and the baby is not in the way.
So that was pretty, a good idea.
Yeah. So that way, I don't have the pressure on my stomach. It's across the shoulder, and it actually helps a little bit more with my posture, you know? So this allows me to get my laundry done, do anything, you know.
Mm-hmm. It looks very convenient.
The vacuum in, the whole nine, when I go to the kitchen. Back in 97, right before I was diagnosed with the breast cancer, I worked at a hospital upstate New York, and I got injured with a patient where I was trying to restrain the patient, and the patient started kicking me in the chest. And that's what brought about all the problems with the breasts and me having the mastectomies and the everything that went with it. It started from that. So I sustained that upper body injury, and it was just like a chain reaction from one thing to the next. And then I started having twisting of the spine, and I swear through the years, I've had 35 surgeries, 2 heart attacks, 2 strokes, and a little bit of everything. So it has nothing to do with my baby, nothing to do with my locks. As a matter of fact, carrying it like this, it actually helps hold me up. Even my mom said to me, you know, you're not slouching over anymore from that injury. You're actually holding up. I said, Mommy, it's the child that you didn't want.